feel like this is one of the strongest misconceptions that I'm seeing, mm-hmm. is that Christians, in the name of Romans 13, they use that passage as a permission slip to give the government totalitarian control. And they even point to the works of Jesus and say, render unto Caesar's what Caesar's, or all these little... What would you speak to the church today? Like, what is your advice to people, the church out there?
Okay, so we have a problem with pastors who are more afraid of losing their 501c3, more concerned about tithes in the pew, so they don't want to upset anybody.
Right.
And they're more afraid of the deacons in the church than they are God himself.
Yeah.
Right? So we have pastors who are idolaters, who are seeking money, and do not fear God more than they fear man. They're not fit for the pulpits anymore.
Yeah.
And what we have are congregations that have been deceived and blindly following these heretics. And we can't allow these people to keep teaching us these things. First and foremost, render unto Caesar what is Caesar's. Fine. But God also said, whose image is on that coin? He was making a comparison, right?
Yeah.
My image is not in the image of Caesar.
Right.
My image is in the image of God.
Okay. Right.
I am created in the image of God. Well, guess what? That means my life doesn't belong to Caesar. My family doesn't belong to Caesar. My liberty does not belong to Caesar. All of those things were given to me by God.
Right.
And for Caesar to come along and say, I have to take your business. No, you're taking what God gave me, not what Caesar gave
right.
me. Oh, I have to stick a needle in your arm. No, I'm sorry. You're taking what God gave me,
right.
my life and my autonomy over my body, and you're giving it, you're expecting me to give it to Caesar. That's not going to happen.
Right.
What people don't realize is the Bible is full of God commanding people to stand up, step out, and be in non-compliance with
right.
tyrannical government.
Right.
You've got the Hebrew nursemaids that were ordered to abort the babies, and they refused.
Right.
That was a law by the king. You have Moses, who was not only disobedient
yeah.
to Pharaoh, but God told him to be disobedient
right.
to Pharaoh, so a whole nation could
right.
be free. You've got Daniel, right?
Yeah.
Daniel. So
refused
Daniel
refused to stop praying.
Well,
refused
no,
to stop.
Before that,
yeah.
Daniel refused to eat the king's
oh,
meat.
Yes.
Okay. So that's not even praying, because
they're
like,
rebel.
Oh, well, that's you know, Daniel refused to pray to the king. That's different. No, Daniel refused to eat the king's mandated diet.
Right.
You can't tell me that is something that, you know, is churchy.
Right.
But he did so because he knew that that's what God commanded
right.
him to do. God didn't let him starve. The
yeah.
Bible says when Daniel and the three Hebrew boys refused to eat the meat, they were stronger, they were healthier,
right.
and they were...
Than all the rest.
And
yeah.
Than all the rest. Then you've got Daniel again, right? The king makes a law. Daniel, if you read that scripture, it says, when he knew the law was signed, he waited to engage in peaceful noncompliance.
Yeah.
And what's amazing, when you go to Daniel 6, the passage... where the king goes to find out if Daniel's alive. Remember, he's freaking out. Daniel looks at him. If you read the scriptures, it says, don't stroke out, king, I'm well.
Right.
He said, God sent me a messenger, and God shut the lion's mouth.
Right. Right.
And what did that messenger tell Daniel? That messenger told Daniel, you are guilty of no crime. You've committed no crime against me, and you've committed no
right.
crime against the king.
Right.
In God's eyes, according to the scripture in Daniel, some laws are no
right.
law
what,
at
what
all.
What would you say if some people say, well, that's just the Old Testament, the New is different, or what would you say?
I would say, okay, we've got Peter and the disciples
okay.
being thrown into prison, and the angels breaking them out
right.
and then telling them to go back and break the law.
Again. Yeah.
Do the same
yeah.
thing. You've got Daniel, you've got John the Baptist sticking his finger
so
in the face of Herod.
So you're saying there's a biblical precedent. This is what I want people to understand.
Mm-hmm.
There's a biblical precedent for believers to stand up when our God-given unalienable rights are in jeopardy.
I would say it's more than a precedent. I would say it's a command by God, proven through Scripture, and rewarded by God himself.
Wow. Wow.